Number 1. History of Wakanda. Now, after the MCU's Black Panther was released, we had a lot of questions about the history of Wakanda. How old is it? We know the mantle of the Black Panther is passed down from generation to generation among the rulers of Wakanda, so who was the first? Now, in the comics, the line of Black Panther stretches back 1 million years to the first Black Panther. At some point, an early human man of the Panther tribe discovered a vibranium meteor and unlocked its secrets, becoming the first to take up the mantle of Black Panther. He became part of a group of prehistoric Avengers that defeated the Celestial Fallen. Now, MCU differs a little bit from the comics, but still has a lot in common. In the MCU, Wakanda is only about 10,000 years old, but many have taken up the mantle of Black Panther. Writer-director Ryan Coogler and his team created a 500-page Wakanda Bible, so clearly a great deal of thought was put into the history of Wakanda, so there will be much to explore in the country's history and heritage. And we could see any number of Black Panthers of the past dealing with many threats throughout history and reveal how the Wakandans discovered the heart-shaped herb that grants a Black Panther their powers. Another interesting take is they could resolve how Howard Stark acquired a sample of vibranium to make Captain America's shield. Now, if anything, Black Panther established that there are a lot of secrets even within the Wakandan royal family, so fans may be getting a Wakanda history lesson when the show comes out. Number 2. Tales of the Tribes of Wakanda. In Black Panther, we were introduced to not only T'Challa and the royal family of the Panther tribe, but the 5 other tribes of Wakanda: the Border Tribe, the River Tribe, the Mining Tribe, the Merchant Tribe, and the Jabari, who are ruled by my personal favorite, M'Baku, who you would definitely want as your personal trainer, giving you the Jabari Trent for those heavy lifts. The Wakandan Bible goes into great detail of each of these tribes, and there is much we could delve into making a spectacular TV show. Perhaps we could see stories from the Border Tribe, who protect Wakandan's borders. They appear as a third world country on the surface, but are actually well-trained combatants with a full arsenal of weaponry at their disposal and would deal with outside threats to Wakanda. Or the Mining Tribe, as they are responsible for the mining of vibranium, the country's most precious resource. What if vibranium fell into the wrong hands again? Or we could see stories from the Jabari, who separated themselves, live in the mountains, and continue practicing the old Wakandian ways without technology. M'Baku was considered as powerful as T'Challa, even without the heart-shaped herb, so his storyline alone would be an interesting thing to follow. Perhaps all the tribes would have to come together to save Wakanda from a threat like Dr. Doom, who's been rumored to appear in Black Panther 2. Either way, there's a lot of tales to be told. Number 3. The Dora Milaje. Though Black Panther featured male protagonist and antagonist, the rest of the cast is made up of almost entirely women. T'Challa may have been the king, but he's surrounded by bodyguards, advisors, and chief technologists who are all women. The bodyguards are known as the Dora Milaje, the all-female royal security force who protect the throne. Danaya Gurira's Okoye is the leader of the Dora Milaje, and one could expect that she could become the protagonist of this series. And she clearly has demonstrated her talents on the small screen with her role on The Walking Dead. And with her character finished in The Walking Dead, this would be a great new series to showcase her star power. In the comics, Wakanda Forever, The Amazing Spider-Man, Okoye, Ayo, and another member which we haven't seen on screen yet, Anake, head to New York to investigate a threat to national security and connect with Peter Parker in the process. In the other comic, World of Wakanda, it's a love story between Ayo and Anake, who is recruited to become Dora Milaje. Their first assignment will be to protect Queen Shuri. So as you can see, the series would not be limited to just Wakanda, but outside threats that require the Dora Milaje. Number 4. Shuri and the Wakandan Design Group. Another of the powerful female characters from Black Panther is Shuri, T'Challa's younger sister, played by Letitia Wright. The MCU Shuri is radically different from the character in the comics, turning her into a teenage genius who is the head of the scientific division of Wakanda, known as the Wakandan Design Group. But that's fine. I like the MCU Shuri. And with Wakanda having opened up its borders and revealed its advanced technology to the world, and after the world has suffered for the past 5 years due to the snap, Wakanda is primed to help the world recover, and Shuri will no doubt become a global celebrity, much like Tony Stark. With WandaVision's introduction of S.W.O.R.D., an organization interested in homegrown threats such as nanotechnology and artificial intelligence, this is the perfect opportunity to link Shuri to WandaVision. Plus, it's possible that with her big brother gone, Shuri could become the one to pick up the mantle and become the female Black Panther. It already happened in the comics, as Shuri takes on the role of Black Panther when Dr. Doom puts T'Challa in a coma, so we may be seeing a female Black Panther in the future. Number 5. The War Dogs. Now, Black Panther established that the kings of Wakanda have agents scattered across the world. These operatives are called the War Dogs, acting as the Central Intelligence Service of Wakanda. They're tasked with collecting information to ensure the safety of the kingdom. Nakia is a member of the War Dogs and T'Challa's lover, who was sent on missions around the world, witnessing the hardships experienced by many people and growing the belief that Wakanda should actively help them. Now, while her actions would never betray Wakanda, other war dogs, like Prince Njobu, went so far as to orchestrate a theft of vibranium from Wakanda in the hopes of arming black insurrections worldwide. When Killmonger briefly took over Wakanda, several groups of war dogs were eager to support his brutal new foreign policy. Now, a show about the war dogs would probably carry a much darker and grittier tone than what Disney Plus and Marvel have planned. So this would be a hard avenue to explore as a series. So we might have to wait until we get a Marvel show on the Stars Network to see this kind of a show come to light. Now, one final idea for a series could be exploring the character of Ulysses Claw, who is played by the wonderfully talented Andy Serkis, who has delighted this fan since his other performance as Gollum.
Yes, you do, precious.
Claw's death in Black Panther always felt like so abrupt and was kind of a letdown. So one way is to explore Claw's earlier days, shortly after he stole samples of the precious vibranium. We could see a young T'Chaka hunting Claw and set up many of the events that would happen in Civil War and Black Panther. Or, as resurrections are possible in the comic world, Dr. Doom could resurrect Claw, just like he did in Secret Wars, and Claw could become a part of Doom's plan to invade Wakanda. Now, according to Deadline, Ryan Coogler has inked a deal that extends his contract with Disney for the next 5 years. So we have 5 years of possible Wakanda shows. We could be seeing one of these, if not all of these, become some part of a reality in the MCU universe. And with Victor Von Doom's character finally in the capable hands of MCU and Kevin Feige, we may be seeing a war between Latveria and Wakanda.